91. Anybody more than 91? All right. Praise the Lord. But Brother Paul, we want to honor you with a special gift. Amen. Amen. Amen, Brother Paul. You're such a blessing. Amen. We love you in the Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord. I'm here today.
Amen. Amen.
I know he's here. I'm here because he wanted me here.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Yes, sir. Happy Father's Day. We love you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. Greatest thing you and I can do is follow Him and walk in His blessings, in His presence, and we're going to give Him thanksgiving. Amen. Let's worship with the choir as they sing this morning. Amen. How many of you are glad today for the name of Jesus? Amen. How many of you are glad you're saved this morning? Hallelujah. It's good to know the Lord. Let's stand together. Turn around and fellowship with somebody. Let them know you're glad to see them here at the house of the Lord. Our children's church, if you'd like your children to go, ages 2 to 6, meet in the foyer. And we want to give God thanksgiving and give Him praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you. You can be seated. We want to give God praise and thanksgiving for all He's done. We also have found a set of keys. Matter of fact, today we found a set of keys. We have a set of keys. You can pick those up at the Resource Center after service. If you are missing those or if you have donated your car, please let us know. We want to thank you for that. And then also, we even found a credit card. So our tithes are going way up today. Please let us know if you have lost any of those things. We'll be glad to return those. And we just want to give the Lord thanksgiving. Amen. At this time, we're going to ask Elizabeth's going to come sing in just a minute. We're going to ask Brandy to come. She has a word on her heart. And then Elizabeth's going to come sing right after that. And we just give God praise. Amen.
astray and wasn't living my life like I was supposed to. God put people in my life, and He guided me back to where I needed to be. And if you're lost and your life's a mess, the only answer is Jesus. It's really simple, and I could not live my life without Him.
Amen. How many of you are glad He'll take all the broken pieces and put you back together again? Amen. Hallelujah. I'm glad this morning we have a Savior that knows exactly where we are and what we need and exactly how to speak to us this morning. We want to give God praise and give Him thanksgiving. Just want to bless the wonderful name of Jesus. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to look at your neighbor right quick. And then look at your Bible. Amen. I don't know what to tell you to do. I need to do something, amen? Hallelujah. I just want to thank God for His goodness and thank Him for being so the Savior that is always near. Friend, I want to tell you something. If you don't know Jesus today, you can. Amen? And I want to promise you something. He will change your life. Amen? I want you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of Acts. Acts chapter number 6 this morning. Acts chapter number 6. And we're going to look at a few verses of Scripture. Verse number 8 as we're going to begin. But as you think about the transition and the transformation that took place in the lives of these believers, these disciples have walked with God. They've walked with Jesus. They've seen all these miracles. They've seen all these things happen. But what effect did it have on their life? Where did their life begin to change? Yes, they are believers, all but one. His name was Judas. Everybody else, they have been saved. They've been following Jesus with all their life. But they begin to change. Something happened to them in the book of Acts, and they were never the same, and neither has this world ever been the same. Do you think God can impact you so much that everything about you can change? What about everyone around you? God can impact us and change us and transform us in such a way that not only we are changed, but everyone around us can know that change, and they can be invited by the Holy Spirit, and it can impact their lives. So there's amazing things that have been taking place all over Jerusalem. As a matter of fact, it is not just amazing, it is total supernatural. I want to tell you, this morning, as believers, we need a supernatural move of God. Amen? We need a power of God, a reviving from God Himself. And so that is what's taking place in the book of Acts. I've been asked many times over these last few days since getting back from Korea, like, what was it like? What is that experience like? What all took place? And we're planning on in July having a Sunday night of just doing a whole presentation on what took place. But I want to tell you what is taking place where I was. It is the book of Acts. The Christians were like in the book of Acts. They were fired up. They were filled up. They were anointed. They were living a life that was for the gospel's sake. And so you watch that taking place in the book of Acts. God is simply unveiling Himself through His disciples. And you see that happening. Now God is establishing, when you come to chapter number 6, God begins to establish the church and what the church is supposed to look like and how we are to be as believers. Look at somebody right now, right quick again, and just say, are you glad to be here? Now, I want to ask you something. Are we ready to be here? Are we ready to be who God has called us to be? That is what the Word of God does, by the way. Y'all do know opening a Bible is not like reading the newspaper, right? It calls us to God. It calls us to who He is and for God to speak His Word into our life. And so in Acts chapter number 6, we begin to see believers that are equipped to do what God has called them to do. How many of you believe today that you have people around your life that need Jesus? I want to ask you something. Do you believe you are the key in their life? When you look at our world and you see what's going on, I do know about what God is doing right here. God wants to use us as a church to reach in our community. God wants to use us in a church to reach into our loved ones' lives. God wants to use us as believers to be the church on earth today, just like they were in the book of Acts. I want to tell you, God is doing great things. Amen? And so you watch as Acts unfolds and you see how these things begin to happen. How we're going to look at a man by the name of Stephen. Stephen was a man that God used. The Bible said he was full of faith and he was full of the Holy Ghost. And you understand about Stephen's life. It was a picture of the presence of God in our life. As they began to set the church in motion in the book of Acts, how they did it by the gifts of those who are walking with God, the gifts of others. Here's what happened. The Word of God increased and the disciples multiplied greatly. And I love this part. And it's found in verse number 7. And the lost were saved. Those who were skeptic, those who had crucified Jesus, those who were the priests began to realize, hey, He is the Savior, and I need Him. I want to tell you something today. Listen, we have a world that needs to know He is the Savior. Amen? And as you watch in the book of Acts what is taking place, this morning we are seeing a transformation taking place in a great way. As a matter of fact, we are seeing the first martyr. And so the book of Acts in chapter number 6 and chapter 7 is about dying. When I talk about dying, it's one of those things that we automatically think of someone, a loved one maybe that has passed away, someone around us that has been dear to us. But I want to tell you, God calls us as believers to die. In order to get where Stephen is, in order to get where these disciples are, there's got to be some dying that takes place. When you think about what is going on in these disciples' lives, they simply did John chapter 3 and verse number 30. He must increase, but what? I must decrease. Hey, he's got to be big in my life. I got to realize how big Jesus really is, how great he is, how powerful he is. And there's absolutely nothing that my God cannot do. He must increase in our lives. Church, I want to tell you something today. As Christians, we're to get a hold of who he is. Amen. And he is all-powerful, all-knowing, almighty God. How that through the book of Acts, this transition that is taking place is this. It means to change. It is to change nature. It also means to change character. It simply means to be changed. Now, I want to ask you something today. Have you ever had that change in your life of coming to know Jesus as your Savior? Yes, no, maybe. Have you been saved before? Hallelujah. Thank you. Amen. I'm sorry to wake y'all up this morning, but I just wanted to ask. Amen. Y'all awake, though? All right. Praise the Lord. When you I guess whenever you go from 400, 500 people being in here screaming amen over and over, sounds a little quieter this morning. Amen. You think about what is going on in the book of Acts. And you understand how in the book of Acts, this transformation that is taking place. I want to ask you something in your Christian life that you know, that you just said, yes, I know I'm saved. I know the Lord. I want to ask you, how is your Christian life transforming? Okay, if we have a baby, and this baby, we feed it some milk, right? Y'all can see it now, can't you? They get milk. But if they never, ever, ever started changing, would you worry something was wrong? If they never went to the bathroom, would you think something was wrong? If you took them back to the doctor and they're not on the growth chart and they've not moved any, do you think something is wrong? What happens in our Christian life? We get saved and then we stop. There's no transformation. There's no continuing of growth. There's that place in our life where we are not allowing God to be God in our life. And so he calls us in the book of Romans. This is Romans chapter 12, verse number 1 and 2. He said, I beseech you, I beg you, if you want to be who God has saved you to be, I beg you to lay down your life as a living sacrifice and give ourselves to God and say, God, here I am. I am so thankful that you save me. I want you to have all of me. Oh, and you understand in that in Romans chapter 12, that's a place of transformation. It's a place that our lives are changed forever. It's a place where he said he has got the increase in my life. So if he has to increase in my life, I've got to empty some things in my life. I want you to look with me in verse number 8 of chapter number 6 from verse number 8, and then we're going to see what is going on in the life of Stephen. Stephen has been chosen along with six others. There's seven men chosen out to serve. And as they are serving the needs of the church. This is where we get our definition of deacons in the church today. They're servants to the church. They're not dictators of the church. They are the servants to serve the people. And so he says, in verse number 8, he said, and Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Wow. When you look at the life of Stephen, there's something that comes to my mind. It's dynamite. Something has changed in the church setting. Something has changed as Christ has went off of the scene. He has ascended back up into heaven. How the Bible says the disciples, they go and they tarry. And they did so, like he said in the book of Luke, until you be endued with power from on high. The disciples step out from behind the curtain of the upper room where they have been praying. And as they do, the Holy Spirit fills them. And God saves 3,000 people that very day. And from that time of those giving their life to the Lord. Now in chapter number 6, we are seeing these who are rising up and saying, yes, I have been saved, and yes, I want to be a vessel for God. And you watch things change. Can I let y'all in on something? Dynamite will change things. Y'all don't know this, but I wired a seat up in here with some dynamite. Somebody's sitting on it, and I got the switch. You know what? You'd be worried about some change going on. Amen. Listen, when you think about in life itself, I really didn't do that, by the way, but you can look just to make sure. Amen. It only happens, I only said it for people that didn't tithe. So, when you understand what is going on, there is a powerful transformation that is taking place in the life of Stephen. As you see, these disciples had have never, you watch Peter. Peter was a man who was up and down in his faith. But Peter, after he is filled with the Holy Spirit, he begins to speak out who Jesus is. Maybe our shyness of who Jesus is not a shyness. Maybe it's a lack of the fullness of the Spirit. Wow. Maybe whenever I don't have boldness in my life, it's not because I'm afraid of what I need to say. Maybe it's because the Holy Spirit don't have all of me. There's dynamite. You watch how these disciples, as things change, how dynamite will definitely change things. As a matter of fact, that's where in these scriptures where we get the word dynamite. We find Stephen. He is the dynamite that changed everything. What Stephen did in his life changed the course of the entire world. One man by the name of Stephen. You say, that is impossible. Oh no, friend. Can I just let you know, that's how much God wants to use us. God wants us to be a vessel that He can use to change others. And you watch that happen in Stephen's life. I love this when it talks about Stephen in verse 8. He said that he was full. That little word full means to be filled completely up. It means to cover over, and it means to be totally complete. Can I let you know something? Sometimes in our Christian life, we begin to feel like we are lacking some things. Anybody ever felt like you've been left out before just because you're a Christian? Would you raise your hand? Wow, you ever thought before, wow, I'm a Christian, but I'm missing out on this. And it's like all these thoughts come. If I could just lay that aside and experience these things, or maybe people don't like me because of this conviction in my life or this thing in my life. Hey, I want to tell you what happens. We need to understand that emptiness that we feel sometimes comes from not being filled with the Holy Spirit. And so the Bible says that he was full. Let's see what he was full, how his life was full. The Bible says he was full of what, church? He's full of faith. And so you understand how where Stephen is walking in. He is not walking in, I hope this turns out right. He is walking on a concrete slab of the assurance. Hey, yes, my God is able to carry me through. Listen, don't lose the confidence that God has for you and that we should have in who God is in our life. If you are a believer today, you have a faith that will stand. That word faith, that means persecution or persuasion rather. It also means a conviction of a religious truth, a reliance upon Christ. It is an assurance. Believers today, I want to tell you something. If you're saved, you're to walk with assurance that God is real, His Word is real, and that God has wherever you are going when you are following Him. Oh, I love that word faith because it tells us something about Stephen's life. It lets us know that in Stephen's life, he's in the Word of God. Because the Bible says this in the book of Romans chapter 10, verse number 17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by what, church? the Word of God. And so you understand how in the world is Stephen have faith to walk through where he needs to walk through. I want to tell you why. Because of the Word of God. He takes God's Word and says, God, I believe you. I trust what you said. And therefore, I have faith as I walk through this journey. The Bible said he is full of faith. The confidence is not in our ability. It is in who Christ is. I love what Jesus says to his disciples. He looks at his disciples and he says this in the book of Mark chapter 11 and verse number 22. He says it real simple. Have faith in God. Would you do me a favor? Look at your neighbor right now and say, have faith in God. You just spoke the Word of God into them. Have faith in God. He is able. So you watch Stephen. He is full of faith. But I love what it said. It said also that he is full of power. Wow, when you think about power, that is a force. It also means, when you talk about power, it is that specifically a miraculous power, a strength, a might with a wonderful word. Remember what Jesus said? It's in Matthew chapter number 28, verse number 18. It's right before Jesus tells his disciples and tells us what we're supposed to be doing. He said it like this. Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. God said, I got all power. So guess what? The Bible says that Stephen is full of power. He is full of God. He is full of God's power in his life. You say, what does that mean to walk in the power of God? When you read about the Apostle Paul, he walked in the power of God. That meant no man, no matter where he stood, no matter what was going on around his life, he walked with a confidence in God and to know that God had all of his life, no matter where he was. He stood before kings and gave his testimony. He stood before jailers and gave his testimony. He stood before the world and gave his testimony. That power is the power of God that works to our life. Here's what he said about us. Y'all ready? Look at somebody and say, Jesus said this to you. Acts chapter 1 and verse number 8 says, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Well, guess what happened in Stephen's life? He's filled with power. He had what God said would happen to every believer in Acts chapter 1 and verse number 8. We'd have the power of the Holy Spirit. And so the Bible says, oh, Stephen, he is full of power. The power of God upon us is a testimony of God in us. The power of God. The Bible says it like this in the book of Romans, that there's power over sin. It shall not have dominion over you anymore. Listen, if you're struggling with sin today, I would check my power source. How many of you ever before, you tried to plug something in and it just didn't work? Did you raise your hand? I saw it on a movie one time. This guy had a bunch of lights on his house trying to get the lights to work. You know what was wrong? The power source. There was no power coming through. God says it like this to me and you. And it's found in the book of John chapter number 15. He said, I want to remind you about something. You are the branch. I am the vine. Stay plugged into the vine and you will have what you need. You will be empowered to bring forth much more fruit, the Bible says in John chapter 15 and verse number 5. Hey, can I tell you today, church? We got to have some power on us. If we don't have anything else, listen, the world needs to see that our God is alive and well and that there's power. The power of God is in our life. It was upon Stephen. It was on Stephen in such a way. There was power over sin. There was power to testify. There's power by the word. There was power to serve. There's power to save. Can I remind you, God has all power, amen, in heaven and in earth. But I love what it says in verse number 8 again. It says this. It said he had miracles going on. I really don't know. The Bible does not go into details about these miracles. But I want to tell you, Stephen was used as a vessel of God. It said in verse number 8 that he did great wonders and miracles among the people. Don't let your mind get twisted by the things that you have seen televangelists do on TV. I'm talking about real miracles that called people to know that there's a holy God. missionaries on the field give many testimonies of people who will come from villages where they have never heard or where they just start hearing about Jesus, and they begin to pray. They ask to pray over their children who are sick and about to die, and they put all weight upon that decision. They put all weight upon the prayer of that missionary, and a miracle will take place so they can know how that God is real. I want to tell you, it is 2018, and my God still does miracles. Oh, Stephen, he was a man full of power and the miracles. That word, it means a supernatural work of God. It is that word, miracles and wonders. It means a mark. It is something that is an identity that happened. Go with me for just a minute, all the way back in the Old Testament, to a place called a little river of Jordan. Wow, it was at a flooding time, and the Bible says that the children of Israel are about to cross over. Joshua, he has the children of Israel following him. They see this river. They understand because they have, some of them have seen and experienced walking through the Red Sea. So they know God can do it. Some of us, we've seen God do great things in people's lives and even in our own lives in the past. We know God can do it. Amen? We need God to work a miracle. They were at a place, the Bible says, that those priests were stepping, and God said, as soon, the very second that your feet touch the water, I'm going to dry it up so you can walk across on dry land. He said, matter of fact, while you're going through the river, have your priest 12 to pick up 12 stones reminding you of where we have been. And the Bible says as they step into that water, that the water begins to dry up, and they stand up again and move back so all the children of Israel can cross over where God said. It was a miracle. And guess what? That word miracle means that there is a marker that is there. God said, I want you to store up. I want you to stack up these stones so that every single person that comes by this way, they will be reminded that we do miracles. Hey, I want to tell you what. God's a miracle working God. Amen. God is able, friend. I don't know what miracle you need today, but I got a God that's able to do miracles. Amen. And when you look at Stephen, he done great miracles. But I want to tell you what, when you think about his life, he had to die to self to become who God wanted him to be. So many times we want salvation, but we want to keep our life. Can I just let you in on a little something? Our life wasn't ours to start with. God saves us so that we can become a vessel of blessing, a vessel of honor, a vessel to glorify Him, a vessel of thanksgiving to walk in the presence of God. When I think about Stephen, it was a place either die to self or be set on the shelf. It's real easy for us just to sit still and do nothing. Amen? What about that place where we say, God, I need your power. God, I need a miracle in my life. God, I need you to do something that is great in my family. God, we need a miracle in my family. It's that place of dying out. Stephen stepped forward and said, yes, I'll serve. Yes, I want to be faithful to God. And so you watch. The Bible says in verse number 9, at the end of verse number 9, that because of what is going on, there's disputings that begin to take place. Can I just let you in on something? Satan does not like it when you begin to serve God. Don't think you're going to serve the Lord and never have any kind of bad thing ever happen in your life. How many of you know it'll happen? Just look at somebody and say, oh, well, it's going to happen. Man, Satan wants to try to disrupt who you are. And when you have that heart like Stephen had, how to serve God, when you're seeing God do great things, and the Bible says here in this verse of Scripture, in verse number 9, that they came and they began to dispute Stephen. It was not just one. They came from all over. And every place that is represented, they began to dispute. You can't argue, friend, I want to tell you, you can't argue with results. I have people that come sometimes and talk to different kinds of religions and begin to have conversation with them. And they tell me how they got started in where they are. Maybe somebody was nice to them, and then they begin to go to church, and they begin to see or a certain place, and they begin to see the change that could happen. And so they started doing this, this, and this. And I say, yes, you know, that's great that you've changed things in your life. But I want to tell you, when Jesus comes in, he changes you. It's not a work. It is a work of God that is in us. You cannot dispute how the results that are happening. Oh, the Bible says, verse number 9 is one of those verses where God just says, here's what happened. The Bible said, and there arose. That means there was a rise up. They had to raise up more because of great number that was found in verse number 7. A great number of those priests that would always bring those accusations have now got saved, and they're over here cheering for Jesus. And so they had to go get some more. Hey, you know what would be the greatest thing that could ever happen in your life for those who you think are your enemies is to bring them to Jesus. He'll change them. Amen. Bible said there rose up, in verse number 9, there rose up more. There were certain of the synagogue. And so they had to raise up more. But I want you to look in verse number 10 and you understand from verse number 10 what takes place. They were not able. Listen to verse number 10. And they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he spake. Wow. Here is Stephen. The Bible said they could not resist it. It means what they heard is stuck. I mean, whenever they heard the word of God that Stephen brought, that God reached into their heart and said, here is the word. Oh, the Bible says it like this. When you go to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 12, the word of God is quick and it is powerful. You know what's happened in their life? The word of God has stuck them in the heart. You know what we need today? We need believers who are bold enough to speak the gospel so it can get to the heart of people. How about us? We're called to that. Y'all know that, right? That is our calling, how to speak the word. It is our calling to reach out to them. Oh, listen, they were cut to the heart, and now they are obligated by the truth to make a decision. I want you to look with me. I'm not going to take time to read all these scriptures, but I sure hope that you will. When we look at Stephen, there's the dynamite. There's the power of God. There's the change that is taking place. Are we willing to lay our life down and say, God, I want you to change me? If I'm not changed, my children are not going to be changed. If I'm not changed, my mama, my daddy is not going to be changed. If I'm not changed, my grandma, my grandpa, those around me are not going to be changed. If I'm not changed, my friends are not going to be changed. God, do a work in me. It's that place of us dying out to self and giving to the Savior, being a vessel. Wow. You know something, when I think about being emptied out, what would it take for us to be empty so we can be full? So many times we have so much in our life. We don't have time for God. We don't have room for the Holy Spirit. We don't have in our life, we don't have our life where we need to be so that we can be a vessel that he can pour. I think about what Jesus did at the marriage of Cana. That very first miracle that we see him publicly do. The Bible said that the water pots were completely empty. He had to have vessels to be able to fill. Wow, when you think about what God can do in your life, you ever thought about being a vessel? What can God do with me? Where Stephen is. I want to give you real quick, there's some deception that happened. We already know from verse number 9 that the enemy came and they began to dispute. Here's what they said. They said, Stephen, by the way, we are bringing up to you. Suborn is what the word means. It means to come under attack. It means we're going to attack you. It means to strike by being underhanded. Can I let y'all know something? Can everybody hear me? The devil does not play fair. He's going to come at you in ways you had absolutely no idea he was coming. We heard in our Sunday school lesson this morning about spiritual warfare that Satan does not come with horns and with a pitchfork. He comes in subtle, the Bible says. He comes in slithering into our life to get us away from God. And that is exactly the deception that is taking place. The Bible said they caught Stephen. They began to try Stephen. They came upon him, which means they assaulted him and brought him to a fake trial. But the Bible says in that that he had a shining face. Look in verse number 15 of chapter number 6. And all that sat in the council looked steadfastly on him. Listen what they saw. They saw his face as it had been the face of what? Of an angel. Can I just tell you something this morning? It's really, really simple. We are a reflection of who we hang out with. Wow, old Stephen, he was a reflection of who he had been with. Moses, the Bible says when he was on the mountain, he comes down, they had to veil him because he was shining like God. They couldn't even look on him. Wow, the Bible says in the Holy of Holies that the presence of God would shine down in such a way that it would cause the smoke of the glory of God to come up. Friend, I want to tell you, we are to be a reflection of Jesus. Oh, it said, old Stephen, as he stands, he has a shining face. The Bible says from verse number 1 down through verse number 50, and I know all y'all said, oh, preacher, please don't. Here's what happens. He began to defend. They said, here's what's going on with Stephen. He has blasphemed against preaching against Abraham, against Moses. He's told all these things. So for 50 verses, you know what Stephen does in front of the whole council? He preaches Abraham. He said, well, I just want to tell you about Abraham. Abraham was our father. I thought it was very interesting how he addressed them in chapter number 7 because he addressed them this way. He said unto them, men and brethren and fathers. Wow. He addressed the fathers. He's not talking about fathers who are leading them. He's talking about those men who are standing in the council. He said, I want you to hearken to what I have to say. He said, the God of glory appeared unto our father. He said, he's the one who is leading us. He was talking about those who are leading religiously, those fathers who are leading them where they need to go. He said, I'm going to tell you something. He said, God appeared unto Abraham. And he begins at Abraham, and he teaches them and shows them every little detail about the life of Abraham. And then he said, and Moses. And he begins, and he gives them the life of Moses. And he says, he had already broke down the lineage. Then he gets to David, and he says, I want to remind you about David. And then he said, and to Solomon. He says, Solomon, with all of his wisdom and all of his glory, he said, here is who he presented. He presented the one I am preaching. You know what he did? He defended the faith. I want to ask you something today. Are we defending the faith? Are we full enough of the Holy Spirit that we defend the faith of God? Do we defend the Scripture as he says in Jude 1 and verse number 3? He said, I exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith. Defend the faith. Something happened. The Bible says in verse number 51 through 54, there was a direct thing that happened. He preached the word to them. And as soon as he preached the word to them, then he looked at them and said, okay, now you, here is where you are. He said, you are stiff-necked. Wow. He also, as he goes through the Scripture, he said, that word stiff-necked means that they know what to do, but they are putting themselves out there not to do it. He said, your heart is in darkness. You are uncircumcised in your heart. Yes, they had everything they needed law-wise, and it looked like they were good on the outside, but they had a darkened heart. Friend, can I tell you today, this is the worst place you and I can ever be. Is walking and doing like everything is right, but be lost on the inside. You may have helped in Bible school this week. Listen, you might sing in the choir. You might be a Sunday school teacher. I don't know what you may do, but I'll tell you what, if you don't have a heart that's been changed by Jesus, we're lost in need of a Savior. It said they were stiff-necked, and then the Bible said then they resisted. The rest of these Scriptures give us a vivid description on the destination of Stephen. The Bible says in verse number 51 that he saw Jesus. How many people on earth get to look up and see Jesus? The Bible says that he saw him standing on the right hand of the Father there in verse number 51. I have witnessed this with people that were getting ready to die and pass over. I had an uncle. I was not with him when he did it, but he had not spoken about, or he's my great uncle, he had not spoken a couple weeks. And all of a sudden, he sits up in the bed, hands up in the air, and said, Jesus is coming after me. was gone. Hallelujah, one of these days, he's coming, amen? Stephen sees Jesus. And as Stephen sees Jesus, oh, the Bible says then they, some men standing there by the name of Saul, they all took their coats. They are stoning Stephen. They take their coats and lay them at the feet of Saul. Saul, the persecutor of Christians. Saul, the one who was determined to stamp out the name of Jesus, is witnessing the stoning of Stephen. He is leading these others in how to persecute Christians. While he's standing there, God gets a hold of the heart of old Saul. Just a couple scriptures later, you see old Saul getting saved. Amen. I don't know who around your life may be that influence, but I want to tell you this. If you'll see Jesus and keep your eyes on Jesus, they can see Jesus in you. Here's what he said. I want you to look at the last verse in verse number 59 and 60 in closing. He said it like this. And they stoned Stephen while he was calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Here's what he did. Now they are stoning him to death. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Wow. You know what you find? You find a man who died to self to go into the presence of the Savior, to glorify Jesus everywhere he went. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your witness, God. Thank you for being so good to us this morning, allowing us to look into your word, God, and be reminded of the miracles you can do. Just like Brandy said just a few minutes ago, God, you're a miracle worker. That nothing is impossible with you. And right now, Father, you know every miracle that needs to take place all over this sanctuary. God, you know everyone in this place that does not know you as Savior and Lord of their life. You know every person in this building today, God, that we need a change from you. Lord, that we need that transformation. God, that there's people all around us. They are looking to us. And God, we need to be shining with the glory of God. Father, I want to praise you for what you're doing. God, I praise you for the opportunity you give us, God, that you might increase and us decrease so that you'd be glorified and people can come to know you. God, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for the sweet presence of the Holy Spirit in this place right now. God, thank you, God, for just speaking to us and giving us the opportunity to be able to call upon you and trust in you. Thank you, Lord, God, for your blessings. Thank you for hearing our voice. And God, thank you, God, that you hear the cry of your children. You know every cry in this building today. I pray your will be done. With heads bowed and eyes closed for just a minute as they begin to play softly. You say this morning, Pastor, in my life, right now, wow, I've got people around me. I've got a sister. I've got friends. I've got grandparents. I've got parents. I've got people in my life today that need to see Jesus in me. Would I be willing to say, Father, help me to die out to self so they can see Jesus. Help me to die out to who I am so that you can be seen. Listen, sometimes we have to lay aside our thoughts, our ways. Sometimes we have to lay aside things that may have happened in our life in the past and say, God, I just want you. Would you be willing this morning to say, I just want to be a vessel that God can use to reach my friends, my loved ones that are on my heart this morning? Listen, I want to invite you to come. I want to invite you to say, Lord, here I am. God, help me that you might increase and I might decrease. Lord, I want to be like Stephen. When they see me, I want them to see you. I want to be shining. God, I want your light to shine through me. As you said in Matthew chapter 5, I'd be a city set on a hill. God, that I may shine. They may see the good hand of God upon my life. You say this morning, listen, I need to come. I want to pray for that person. I want to pray for them that God would work in their life, that God would use me as a vessel in their life. Hallelujah. Some of you may have a dad that don't know Jesus. Hey, it may be a good day to come pray for them. What a Father's Day to see them give their life to Jesus. You say this morning, in my life today, I've got people around me that need Jesus. Hey, it'd be good to say, God, I want to be like Stephen. I want to give my life. I want to give myself so you can be glorified. You say this morning, Pastor, as God is speaking to me, as God is working in my life this morning, listen, I'm at that place. I need to be filled with the Spirit. I need to be filled with God's wisdom. I want to be filled with faith. I want to walk in His power. I want God to do something in my life personally. I need God to help me. Maybe you've been away from the Lord. Maybe in your life, you know you trusted Jesus, but you walked away from Him. Maybe a day you want to say, God, I need you to restore me. I want to invite you to come. Listen, we want to take God's word. God, I don't need you to restore my life. I need you to restore my testimony. God, I want you to restore me so I can live for you and lift you up. Maybe today you say, Pastor, in my life, I've never trusted Jesus, my Savior. And today, I don't know Him. And if I died today, I'd be in hell. Friend, I want to tell you, that is why Jesus died on the cross, so that you and I could know Him. You say this morning, I need Jesus in my life. Friend, He died on the cross for you. The Bible says that 3 days, He was in the grave, His body. But on the third day, He arose. After that third day, he said it like this, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. I want to ask all over the building, if we'll just stand together with heads bowed and eyes closed while these are praying. You say this morning, Pastor, I need to come. I need to come this morning. I've got somebody in my life, they're lost. I got somebody in my life, but if God don't break through their life, they'll be in hell. Friend, I want to tell you, we have a Savior who knows where you are. Listen, would you come this morning? Would you come while you're trusting God? Lord, I need you. God, I need you to work in my life. You say this morning, Pastor, in my life personally, wow, I need God to help me. I need God to restore me. Can I tell you something, friend? He will. Hallelujah. God wants to restore your life. You say this morning, Pastor, I'm really not sure I know Jesus. I'm not sure that I have that assurance that Stephen had, that Jesus is mine and I'm walking with Him every day. Can I tell you, you can have that assurance. He said, these things have I written unto you, that you may know that you have eternal life. That is where God is. God wants to give you that assurance this morning. He loves you. Hallelujah. He loves you. He wants you to know, glory to God, you are His child. Praise the Lord. God is so good. You say this morning, Pastor, God is just speaking to me this morning about something specific. Let me pray about that. Would you just slip your hand up? There's something God is speaking to me about in my life. God bless your heart. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Listen, I want to tell you, friend, God knows where you are. He knows what is going on in your life. God knows exactly how to speak to you. All these are coming, and while God is just speaking, listen, just let Him. Hallelujah. Listen, just let Him work in your life. God is so, so good. Will you join me as we pray together? You say today, Pastor, I'm really not sure that I know Jesus. It'd be a good day to say, God, I want you to come in my life. I want to be saved. I want to trust you right now, right where I am. Hey, God made it so simple. We're going to pray in just a minute. You can pray and ask God to come in your life. You say, Pastor, I need to be restored in my life. I've walked away from God. I've got sin in my life. I've done things I shouldn't have done against God. Can I tell you what, friend? He wants to restore you. God wants to restore your life. You say this morning, I got loved ones in my life that need Jesus. Let's trust God for them. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. Thank you, God, for the opportunity you've given us right here this morning. God, to look at a man by the name of Stephen, that you worked through his life in such a way, God, that his life influenced and changed the whole world. Father, I praise you, God, for the power, God, that's upon lives when we trust in you as Savior and Lord. God, the opportunity, the availability, God, that we have by dying out to self and living for you. And God, I pray every single day we'd allow you to be the Lord of our life. God, that dynamite, the life-changing power, God, will be upon us, that people would know and see Jesus into our life. Help us to shine for your glory. Father, I want to pray with those this morning that have never trusted you as Savior and Lord. God, that even right now, right where they are, Lord, they would confess, God, I am a sinner. Jesus, I believe you came and you died for me on the cross. You died for my sins. You was buried. And the Bible says on the third day you arose. Jesus, I believe you. I trust what your word says. I ask you to forgive my sins. Come in my life, Lord. I want to commit my whole life to you, to live for you, to walk with you, to serve you, and God, to thank you every day for your salvation. Lord, and right now, I give you my life, and I give you praise for your blessings in Jesus' name. Father, I want to pray with those right now that have walked away from you. God, you restore their lives. You said, if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, you want to cleanse us. And Father, we just pray right now, God, forgive us, Lord, God, where we have sinned. God, those individual sins, those things in our life that you're speaking to us about, we just confess them before you right now. ask you to restore our life. God, restore our heart. God, restore us and revive us for your glory. Father, I want to pray, God, right now for our lost friends and loved ones. God, Stephen gave the word. He understood where the people were. God, he answered their question by getting in the word. God, as he did, Lord, you touched a man's life that would never be the same again. God, may we be that same one with our friends and family and those around us. God, that we'd have the boldness by the fullness of the Holy Spirit in our life, the power and faith that the Word of God gives us, that you can do a miracle in their lives. We love you. God, we want to give you praise for all you've done and for who you are. God, may your will be done in and through our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you this morning, you believe God? Amen. I'm glad he knows exactly what we need. I'm going to ask a welcome committee, if you will, to make your way to the door. And also, we have something we're going to do right quick to two fathers.